I want to kick us off by saying that we're going to talk more about building our own toolkit, being our own emergency first responder to restore our energy. And we'll talk a little bit about the goals that we're going to achieve today and how stress is not bad, right? It's just how we deal with it and how we ground ourselves. So let's kick it off and get started.
Okay. And before we do, just realizing I should have asked you during break, Dina, just so we all know, can you confirm when the stop point is for us? Because I want to honor your time.
Yeah, you guys can take as long as you need. We were just going to end totally at 5 o'clock, and we had planned to just do a Q&A at the end. And perfect. So you know, whether that's 15 minutes or so, that's perfect. So whatever you need to do, because you're great about stopping in between. So whatever you need to do is great.
Okay, thank you. That's helpful. Okay, so here we go. Okay, so what are we going to focus on in this second time with you? We're going to start by just naming what we came to discover are some of the problematic or maybe limiting ways that we talk about self-care in general. Not us. We try to actually push beyond that, you'll see today. But in general, what's out there in the books and what's out there kind of in society, it can be limiting. And then we want to talk about why we think that's limiting. Going to exploring how culture really influences our sense of self, our understanding of healing, our even perceptions of stress and trauma, and certainly, like I said, this way in which we think about coping, healing, and building resilience. And then we're really going to give you, we're going to sort of walk through in a little bit more depth some strategies. We won't have time to go through them all, but we'll walk through some self-care strategies. And at the end, we've got handouts like toolkits and things that will help you get started. Okay. And as we said before, feel free to share publicly, privately, unmute yourself, all of those things. Okay. Let me see something. Oh, there we go. Lost my cursor. Okay. Julie?
You know, I'm going to keep this brief because this is a reminder connecting us to our last keynote. But I mean, life is like a roller coaster. Day in and day out, we go up and down that continuum that Julie mentioned, that arousal staircase. It's not that we want to make all of the stress go away in our lives. It's inevitable if you're human that you experience stress. It's like this teacher that I interviewed who told me that she used to say to herself, I'm only going to be happy when I have no stress. And she told me, I found out that I was never happy until I learned about, I don't know if she said the word is a hurricane or a tornado, where in the center is the eye of the storm. And she said, I want to be like that. No matter what chaos is blowing around me, I want to be like the eye of the storm. So I learned, Julie, that I had to build these grounders to keep me centered and to protect me when the winds would blow. And that's what we're sort of talking about today, how to balance that stress when we feel those intense storms of big emotions coming.
Okay. And we talked about this, so I'm not going to go into it, but I do want to just bring our attention to this. I think it's been really, really helpful for Dr. Nadine Burke-Harris and others who have spread the word about adverse childhood experiences and the impact of stress and trauma on learning, development, functioning, and so on. However, it has also caused some harm for people to feel that sense that stressors and trauma are a life sentence. There's nothing farther from the truth. We need to balance our discussion of stress and trauma with resilience because so many studies have shown that you can't look at somebody's adversity and predict their future because it all has to do with this buffering and these forms of stress reduction. So just remind yourself that there are factors that you have control over that can help you with your resilience. Okay. So what are some of these? I'm going to name a few that we came up with, Julie and I, and our colleagues, and we were writing our book on self-care. These are some of the things that we notice when we think about early childhood as a profession. Widely, you know, I would say people who serve young children and families or the workforce. And so what we notice when people talk about self-care, they're often using language or beliefs or practices that are really overwhelmingly kind of rooted in Western, Eurocentric, and often middle class customs, beliefs, practices, and an assumption that people have financial capability to do things like go to a spa, or that they don't live in a rural area, that they could access things like, you know, whatever the recommendation is. But for many people in our field, these things are not accessible financially, or they're not meaningful culturally or individually, and they don't bring them that sense of feeling refreshed, feeling rejuvenated. And I'm talking about things like the spa, or, you know, writing in a journal, or taking a yoga class, or what have you. So these can be helpful for some people. We're not here to dismiss anybody's self-care, but we're here to say it's too limited. The other idea, the second one here, is we felt there's a language that's always talking about how stress management is the responsibility of teachers, providers, and it's something individual that they should be doing after work. Like that, yes, definitely do your self-care. But there isn't a sense that part of what creates the stressors, and in some cases, the traumatic stress, are the conditions of our work that are rooted in these long-standing structural inequities, right? The lack of compensation, the resources, the sort of stressors that our children and families are experiencing that goes right into our bodies, right? Stress is contagious. So we wanted to open that up and say it's the individual, it's the organization, it's the system, and we have this collective responsibility. We can't just say to teachers, you know, this is your thing to do. And then the final one here is that we always talk about teachers being regulated and engaging in self-care so that they can do better work with young children, or they can show up aligned to their values and do no harm. But like I said earlier in the keynote, we also care about you. We want you to do this so that you don't experience harm on your own bodies. Julie, do you want to add anything?
No, I don't. Thank you.
Okay. So let's dive into when we thought about our work, why did we title it culturally responsive self-care? Well, if we recognize that there's such a sort of limited understanding of how we're thinking about culture and our current discussions of self-care, we wanted to make that visible to all of you. So I know that the words are pretty small here, but I wanted to just show you, and we've all understand this metaphor of the iceberg, that there's the thing on the top of the water that we often talk about when we think about culture, what we describe as surface culture, foods and arts and dance and literature and games and celebrations and things like that. And that those are parts of culture. But if you look underneath the water here, these are all additional aspects. And of course, this isn't an exhaustive list. There's even other things that are part of culture. Sometimes they're unspoken rules. Sometimes it's just the way we're socialized in our families and communities to sort of live our lives. We don't even think about it intentionally. But let's look at some of these. So our concept of time, of personal space, how the patterns of handling emotions, like what's appropriate of how you, which emotions you can express, how you express them, tolerance for physical pain, the concept of the past and the future. Many of my Indigenous colleagues talk constantly about, you know, thinking many generations into the future in their concept of time. Time or with knowledge keepers and elders and ancestors thinking into the past. I mean, so there's lots of aspects of culture there. Our attitudes around problem solving, dependence, like what do you expect people to do on their own and what do you think about them doing in community?
Well, looking at this,
Oh, if anybody has something to say, feel free to unmute. But child rearing, our personal space, our facial expressions, our sense of touch, is that, how do you feel about that? And it turns out that our concepts of self are really, really informed by culture. And all of us here, like you're all in Wyoming, so there's things that you share, but there's probably, well, I'm certain of it, there are many things because of the families you grew up in, the time in which you grew up, the community you grew up in, your individual dispositions and beliefs and interests and so on that are very diverse here. So before we move on, feel free, you know, if you look here and you sort of, I just want you to, you don't have to share these out, but I just want you to notice one category here. Maybe your concept of time or eye contact, what you learned as a child or how you practice that now. I just want you to think about one, connect this to yourself in one way and just think to yourself, you know, how do I see myself in this? What was a value or a belief or a cultural routine that you grew up with? And I'm going to move forward. As you think about that, we draw from one of our favorite people, Rudine Sims Bishop. You might have heard of her. She talks about this metaphor of mirrors, windows, and sliding doors. She talks about it in terms of literature and giving especially young children of color what she calls mirrors. But for all of us, a mirror is something that it reflects back to us. Something that we're familiar with, that we know, that is part of our lived experience, our cultural beliefs and routines. And she says every child deserves that in their classrooms. It helps them feel a sense of belonging and respect and valued and safe. And we would say, yes, absolutely. And every adult should experience that in discussions of self-care. So we hope that all of you will see ways in the way we think about this that are super comfortable, familiar for you. But she also talks about windows, and that is looking through to somebody else's cultural belief or self-care routine or sense of healing, a strategy for building resilience. It's not at all familiar to you. You look through the window and you look at it and think, well, that's interesting. I might want to explore that. It's new and different to me. And a sliding door is when you're opening that door and literally trying it out. Now you may try it out and it may work for you and it may not, and that's okay. We want to build the continuum to be wide and to recognize this is dynamic. You're going to be trying things out, and things that work today may not feel as refreshing and meaningful tomorrow, and that's okay. We just want you to have a wide continuum. Okay, so here we are, recognizing that iceberg and what's underneath the surface. We want to think about culturally informed beliefs about, let's first think about self, and then I'm going to talk about healing. So some of you, and oh, I should have said this, some of the beliefs that you grew up with, you may still find are relevant to you and meaningful. And some of you may find that things you grew up with, you recognize as the way that you lived or were socialized, and you might not still find those meaningful, and you might have claimed different beliefs. Okay. And that's, again, we want to acknowledge all of those range of experiences here. So some of you might have grown up with, or currently, when you think about the self, some cultural beliefs are the self as independent, the self as somebody who should be self-actualized, somebody who should have, like, as an individual, you have your own goals, your own beliefs. You think about yourself as an independent actor, and maybe that was independence was really important. And what you could do as an individual was really emphasized. That's one end of a continuum. And then on the other end of a continuum, and remember, there's no value judgments. There's no right or wrong. These are just cultural variations. On the other end of a continuum, people grow up with the idea of self as, I think of myself as always in relationship to others. So you might have been socialized in your family or in your community to think about yourself not as an individual who's independent from others, but who's interrelated with other people or the environment, the land, the animals, you know, the ancestry. That's just a very different orientation to self. And this is a whole continuum, and you might experience a little of both. But self-care in the traditional dominant perspectives has only talked about this end of the continuum with self as individual. So we want to recognize that wide range. Then this slide talks about this continuum of culturally informed beliefs about healing. A very kind of dominant, very familiar for many people, although not all, model of healing looks to, it's a Western medical model. And it looks to thinking about what are stressors, what are symptoms of maybe an illness or a problem that I have. You might go to a traditional Western doctor and say, I'm having headaches or stomach aches, or I'm feeling depressed, you know, feeling anxiety or what have you. And they take apart each of those symptoms and think about how to give you particular interventions or medication or different kinds of therapies, right, to address a symptom. So that's one way that's very common and popular for addressing healing, is sort of thinking about what are the symptoms and how do we approach it with an intervention. For folks who are on the end of the continuum where self is often woven in a more interdependent context, healing might be thought of in very different ways. So instead of naming what's wrong and focusing on the problem or healing something, you might think about where there, you might create greater balance. Is something out of balance? And how might I focus on creating more balance? Do I need to focus on more connections to community? Do I need to connect more with nature and my ancestors? Is my spiritual life needing more focus and balance? So this sense of even the language we use to talk about healing and self-care and coping is really, really different depending on your cultural beliefs and orientation. Okay. This is just an example of, you know, some of the ways that we've heard from people. The storytelling here in the corner, you can see the sort of connection to telling stories of our cultural practices, our history, our ancestors, our elders, our knowledge keepers, and keeping that going through the generations. That might be, for some communities, an absolutely powerful and important and essential form of healing and coping. Others, you know, connecting to dance, being in nature, connections to the land. These are all important aspects of healing that are, and coping and building resilience, that have been, we think, pretty much left out of the discussions of self-care. And you can see that connecting these to our keynote, yes, in the dance, there's somatosensory regulation. Yes, in the storytelling, there's relational regulation. I mean, there's some of those pathways to regulation we can name here, but even more importantly, there's these cultural orientations to how we think about what it means to experience stress and experience healing. Julie, do you want to add anything else?
I think I will when we get to the next slide. Thank you.
Okay.
I know we've talked a lot about balance, right? We keep bringing that scale back. And there's also a balance between my own self-care and caring for others. I'm going to start by reading this quote by Ann Tam. Self-care is healing both my body and my self-worth. Knowing my value and that I am loved. I believe that self-care means being truthful about my own experience. Talking about my suffering and pain, I often listen to everyone else's pain and empathize with others, but I don't feel that I have the same permission to share my own pain. Now, in my interpretation of this, there is this understanding that when we name our emotions, we can tame them. We've talked about that before, But there's another understanding here that I think that many of us have been given the gift and the blessing of having these superhero powers on this planet of helping others. And the kryptonite to that, the thing that makes us weaker in our giving power, is when we don't do it for ourselves. So that might be the very thing that we have to pay attention to, is how we do this for ourselves as well. Because you can't give any more to others than you've given to yourself. And so that's the way that I feel when I look at this quote. I don't know, Julie, do you want to add something?
Well, Anne was somebody on, Tom, was somebody that we interviewed for our book. She was an early childhood coach and a director. And she was very much from a collectivist cultural context, where she said it was not natural or culturally aligned for her to think about her own needs as an individual. She always thought about, what are the needs of my family, my supervisees? And we said, well, we absolutely would never advocate you being asked to do something that is culturally incongruent, but how can you become part of the group? Because right now you're actually meeting only others' needs and you're completely exempting yourself. And so that was what we thought about with her. And we want to give you that invitation to think about, you know, where are you? And without any, just noticing how you feel about giving yourself permission to care for yourself, noticing where you are on that continuum without any self-critique or self-judgment, you know, in mindfulness, you just notice without any evaluation. Because one of the things we want to call you into as an invitation is, if you are thinking that brings up feelings of guilt or discomfort to think about caring for yourself, we want you to just notice that and kind of give yourself an opportunity to think about why that might be and how you might begin to lean into that and think about it. Okay, so we're going to now start going into, with some of that as a background, recognizing we want you to have windows, or I should start with, we want you to have mirrors. We want you to have windows, and maybe by the end of this, feel some courage and sort of a willingness to have some sliding doors that you walk through, things you want to try that are new, and maybe things that you see and say, I just really want to, I saw things that are mirrors for me that I want to reinforce and make sure that I do intentionally. So we're going to go into introducing several different self-care activities. We want you to think about, some of these are going to be interesting and meaningful and some may not, and that's okay. Because for you, you're going to choose the things that are helpful for you.
And I know for our first activity, we're going to practice. And one of the things we're going to think about together collectively is how self-care includes self-awareness. Being able to read my unique fingerprint of my clues inside my body that tell me what my internal state is in the moment. You see, many times as humans, we are raised by parents and teachers and caregivers to cast the spotlight of our attention outward all day in and day out. And very few people ever helped us cast this. I'm not saying for everybody, but for many humans, very few people, when we were being raised, help us spend as much time casting the spotlight on the universe that lives inside of us, of emotions and sensations and thoughts and feelings, and how to make sense of that universe so we don't allow it to hijack us in places where we can often react without thinking, without the cortex, and sometimes in ways that we regret, or we want to take back, or we hurt others, or even ourselves, or the things around us. So it starts with self-awareness, and cultivating it is what we're going to practice now. Now, my invitation to you is to help me. When we do this training, pretty soon you'll go into a breakout, but when we do this training, typically we're in person. So small groups go up to a flip chart like the ones you've seen now. in a moment, you're going to go to a very short breakout to do this virtually. But let's practice first. The invitation is to wonder, what do I, Julie Kurtz, or you, or Julie Nicholson, what do we each individually look like when we have high levels of stress in our body physiologically? Now remember, physiological sensations in our body are connected to our survival hind reptile brain. They are very wise. It's our reptile survival brain going, hello, the stress is getting too high. Therefore, I'm going to give you a stomach ache and then maybe you'll pay attention and do something. Oh, you don't want to pay attention. Let me give you a headache. Then maybe you'll listen to the stress we're having. And instead, when we take the Advil, that's okay. That's good. I love Advil. Or a Tums, right? We're not getting to the core issue of the stress. So here are two examples of groups that did a visual picture of what they look like when they went up to the flip chart. So I'm going to walk through the picture on the left. This particular group had physiological symptoms that show up when they have high levels of stress. Can you see the cloud in the head? That means cloudy thoughts for one person, or a lightning bolt shooting through their head, or an eye twitching, flame in their shoulder, clenching of the jaw, or a saw on their shoulder to represent the pain in their shoulder, or their lungs fill up with liquid, right? Like you can't breathe. Notice the drum in the heart that symbolizes my heart starts beating fast, sweat coming from the armpits, the pretzel that represents how this one person's stomach gets twisted up and knotted, and another person drew yellow lines down to represent the sciatica that they experienced. Now, just to practice a little more, looking at the right picture, you can't see all of it. There's a little green alien outside of the body on the left-hand side that you can see a sliver of. Is anybody willing to type in the chat box one thing you observe that in the right-hand picture represents stress? You can see that there's weights on the shoulder, ringing in the ear, even the lightning bolt down the chest, right? Weight on the shoulder, Carrie, yes, thank you so much. We'd like to have you practice. This practice will lead to the next activity that will allow us to build upon that. Julie, do you think we have time for a short 3-minute breakout for folks to talk, or what do you think?
Yeah, I think so. I think it's important. So do I set that up or do we?
I can set that
okay.
up.
Okay.
I'm going to make the breakout rooms a little bit bigger this time because not everybody chose to go last time. And we want to make sure that everybody's in one together. How's that sound?
That sounds great. And it's just enough time for you to think about if this was a scan of you, where would your stressors be, right? Is that what you want them to do?
Yes. Okay. So when you go, it's very quick. Each person gets a chance to say either where in their body do they have stress or the image that represents that stress in our bodies. Okay. So very quick breakout, maybe no more than 3 or 4 minutes. I'm going to open the rooms right now. You can accept the invite. If you don't see it, it could be hidden behind something you have pulled up, and we will see you in a short 3 to 4 minutes. I'm checking the breakouts to make sure nobody's alone, just to make sure.
Julie, I'm going to go join room one. There just looks to be like maybe 3 people in there, so I'm going to go jump in.
Beautiful. So Julie, in about 30 seconds, they'll been in the breakout 3 minutes. I think I'll close it, which will give them 60 more seconds. There's not a lot of people in most breakouts.
Perfect. Okay.
Okay. If you're with us in the main room, I close the breakouts. They'll be back in about 60 seconds. All right, everybody is now coming back from the breakouts. Mm-hmm. Welcome back, everybody. Now, I'm gonna ask you to hold some of the comments that you made for the next activity where you'll have a chance to be able to share out some of your own examples, because this builds into the next activity, Julie. So we'll go to that.
Okay.
Now, this is a tool that you can access for free on the website that I'm going to put in the chat box in English and Spanish. And it is a tool called the Zones of Self-Awareness. And let me tell you a little bit about it. I'm putting the website into the chat for you to access the handout later, although I'm sure you already got a copy of it. Now, this Zones of Self-Awareness is designed to do the very thing we've been talking about, is cultivating your own self-awareness. Now, there are three zones on the front of the Zones of Self-Awareness, and the backside we're going to be building in later, your grounders. The left is the green zone, the middle is the orange, and the right is the red zone. The green zone is where we are when we are optimally regulated, when we feel grounded. Maybe we don't have a lot of stress, or we've been using a lot of things to buffer our stress. That's our optimal zone of regulation. That's when our cortex is open for business and we can access it. When we move into the orange zone, we have moderate levels of dysregulation and some early warning signs. And then when we move out of the zone of optimal arousal or regulation into the red zone, that's usually when our survival brain wakes up, the alarm has gone off, and we move into our own various forms of fight, flight, freeze. Now, let's walk through the different clues that we can practice learning about ourselves that we have in each zone. The first one, we just did a whole practice around that. The physical body sensations come from the survival reptile hind brain, the stomach aches, the headaches, the neck pains, or even a calm, relaxed shoulders or calm body can indicate what zone we're in. The feelings,
Did you figure out how to move it?
Whoops, let me just make sure I mute everybody. Let's double check everybody's muted. Okay, there we go. All right, so the second clue are feelings and emotions that come from our mammal or limbic brain. And sometimes clues what level of stress or zone we're in can be the feelings we have. The third clue comes from the top of our brain, the cortex, the thoughts we have racing or beating ourselves up or being really calm thoughts, being thoughts that are calm. And then the fourth clue is our behavior. Sometimes we can tell what zone we're in by the behavior that we exhibit. This is an example of Kyla. In the green zone, Kyla has physical body sensations that are relaxed shoulders, regular breathing, but in the orange, tension in her face, clenching of the jaw. When she moves into the red zone, she gets a headache, stomach pain, or eyes twitching. Let's look at Kyla's next clues that she filled out. feelings coming from the mid-limbic brain. In the green zone, she's calm and happy. In the orange, worried and anxious. And in the red, utter panic and terror, that up the top of the staircase of the arousal continuum. Third clue, thoughts. In the green zone, her thoughts tend to be, I'm just doing the best I can. Others are doing their best. Let me give them some grace. In the orange zone, Kyla says, you know what, Julie, I'm not sure what thoughts I have in the orange zone. I haven't quite figured that one out yet. But in the red zone, she literally hates everybody herself and her job. You know how you could go in the middle of Walmart when you're in the red zone and everybody's aggravating you? That's how she gets. The fourth clue is the behavior, right? And sometimes we only notice our behavior. In the green, Kyla's patient, kind to herself and others, and easygoing. In the orange, shut down and unfocused. And in the red, yelling or criticizing others or very self-critical. Now, a couple clues before we invite you to practice. Actually, if we could go to the next slide, it'll be a blank slide. In a moment, we're going to give you about 3 minutes with some music to wonder to yourself, or maybe we should go back to the other slide because this one doesn't show all the categories. Maybe that would be better. There we go. So this is where we're going to have you practice in just a moment. But before I do, I want to give you a couple of warnings. Number one, there is no good or bad zone. They all are valid, and we all are in different zones at different times of the day, the week, the month, or the year. We honor where we're at, and when we recognize it, then we can take action to disrupt the things that we tend to do when we get into that zone. The second thing is when you fill this out for the first time, you may not have all four clues every time. And it varies depending on the situation you're in. And many people have said to me when they do this for the first time, Julie, I know green when I'm calm and I know red, but orange, I can't quite figure out yet. Well, it took me years to cultivate this self-awareness. So give yourself grace today. Also, one last clue is that this can be triggering for some to do for the first time, especially if you're in a highly emotional state. For example, because of some of the trauma that I experienced as a little girl, to do an activity like this when I wasn't ready may have opened up too much self-awareness, too much focusing on my internal world, when before I actually shut down from my internal world to protect myself. So when we invite you to do this, we ask you to either do it in the way that you feel safe, take a breath and use some of those strategies Big Bird used to regulate, or maybe don't do it at all. Just notice as you are thinking about it. Julie, did I miss something that we usually cover?
I mean, you started to talk about this at the final comment there. If you have a history of trauma, it may be that you're most comfortable and most familiar with the red zone. Yes. Do you want to say anything about that? Usually you make a comment about that, but
that's right, Julie. Mm-hmm. You know, someone like me, I've spent my whole life growing up as a child, not my life after that, just living in the red zone. And so sometimes for some of us, the red zone feels more familiar and the green zone actually becomes scarier because it's not so familiar. And that can be a common experience that you have. In fact, whatever you experience is okay when you do this. We just want you to take care of yourself and only do what you feel safe doing today.
So I'll put on some music and why don't you tell them what the prompt is and then...
Yeah. So we know that none of this is long enough to really dig deep. It's just the beginning of touching the surface and for you to think about doing this later. But during the music, approximately 3 minutes, it's a time for you to tune inward and to jot down a few notes that you're familiar with about yourself. Are there any clues you have in the green zone, the orange zone, or the red zone? You're welcome to type privately or publicly in the chat during this quiet time, if that helps you. But we're going to be in silence for 3 minutes and then we'll come back with one another. Momentary invitation as we begin to slowly move away from this activity and turn the music down. Take 30 more seconds just to see if you feel comfortable sharing in the chat one clue that you have, whether it's green, orange, or red. Just 30 more seconds of silence, and we'll invite that if you feel comfortable, and then we'll move on.
Whoops, that was my 3 minutes.
That's the 3 minutes. We've got one comment, Julie, that says in the green, kind to self and others. Yeah, yep. Green, forgiving of imperfection of myself. Yes. Thank you so much, everybody. We encourage you to continue to type your comments. Oh, another one, orange, clenching everything. Yes. Our body physiologically matches our emotional state. Someone else shared, I notice my behavior when I'm slipping out of green into orange or red. I'm less willing to engage with others. I isolate. Another, red, stomach pain. Another is orange. I'm stressed when I start rearranging furniture. See, so you're noticing the behaviors. Rearranging furniture could mean I feel out of control. So I'm trying to do something, right? That's exactly. Yep. Thank you all so much for joining in this tool and activity of cultivating that self-awareness.
There's one more from Amber.
Let me take a look. Amber, the green is happy with a smile, trying to listen to others. Yes, and another comment, orange. Begin to have sleep issues is what I'm assuming. Yes, your sleep starts to get impacted when you move into the orange zone. Mm. Yep.
And the goal, let's make some connections, Julie, before we will move on. But the more you build this self-awareness and you know where you are in that arousal continuum, the more you have a sense of agency and control to say, wow, I'm in the red zone. If you're in the red zone and you just start very activated, very stressed. Remember what we said, the somatosensory activities go right to the core regulatory network. So you want to do something that helps you calm down as fast as you can, which are some of those like getting up and stretching, going out in nature, you know, moving, humming, singing, listening to music. But the other reason is if you start to cultivate that awareness, and you notice that you're moving from green to orange, and let's say that you're noticing that it's impacting your sleep or you're rearranging furniture, If you have those cues, the clues that your body is giving you about your stressors, and you can use any of those pathways, you pick up the phone and call a friend, or you text a colleague, or, you know, whatever it is, you look out the window at nature and think of your happy place, you're going to probably interrupt those stress chemicals from being released and harming your body. So these things are all going to connect together for why, you know, you're going to have some agency and control to help you. And then we can teach this to other people, and we can teach it to children.
That's right.
Okay.
So one of the interviews we did was of Monique Lee, and I'm going to read this quote. "What I've learned over the years is that when I start to feel dysregulated, my heart starts to race. And I've learned just to be aware of my heartbeat. When it starts to go faster, that is a trigger for me to notice and stop and say, wow, something must be bothering me. I'm not feeling quite right. I wonder, and I'm curious what that's about. I kind of go through a quick check-in with myself to consider what's going on in my mind too, to make me feel anxious. Once I identify it, I start to make a plan as what I need to do with that feeling. A lot of times just sitting and breathing, taking a short break, washing my hands." I mean, this is really powerful, Julie, this quote. It was so much wisdom. And I'm sure all of you, if we spent time with each of you, would have small, brief ways that you cultivate that pause, but also notice. Mm-hmm. The more we notice what our body looks like, the more we can actually pause and then make a choice that's mm-hmm. different from the ones we sometimes make. Yep.
And here she is just breathing. So that's somatosensory, and washing her hands, just going over to the sink and letting that water fall on. There's the sensory. Right, that regulates right away the core networks. Okay.
And we're going to talk about another bottom of the brain strategy. I could do this for an hour and 15 minutes, Julie. Literally, I do a training for that long on all the different strategies of the breath, but let's just do a highlight today. Your breath is a very powerful free remote control for you to regulate. Again, bottom of the brain strategy, one of the fastest pathways. But interesting to learn about the breath. Did you know you have 10 pounds of muscle around your lungs and you take 17 to 20,000 breaths per day in and out? Whoa. Well, our breath matches our level of anxiety. So when we notice, like the previous quote, that our breath or our heart starts racing, our breath becomes shallow, we can actually use our breath to anchor and ground us. You see, the in-breath is the accelerator of our body and stimulates the sympathetic nervous system, tells our body to accelerate. When we do an out-breath, it stimulates the parasympathetic nervous system of the body, and it sends messages through our autonomic nervous system to put the brakes on and slow down. So when you're in the green zone, you tend to have even breathing you don't even notice, because the brakes and the accelerator are like in the 55 mile an hour freeway zone. But as soon as you start getting into stress, some of your heart starts racing and your breathing becomes shallow and rapid. Then you are the folks when you have increased levels of anxiety and you need to do out breaths, like to put the brakes on. So you could do an in-breath in 3 seconds and make your out-breath a little bit longer, 5 to 7. That will send a message through your body. Oh, the out-breath is longer. I should just calm and slow a little bit. If you're somebody that goes to freeze, like shutdown mode, where you become immobile, you might need a little more in-breath to get you out of that so you can access your thinking brain. So breathing is unique depending on the situation, but if you're amped up, stressed out, moving into the red zone and have a lot of anxiety, one simple breathing technique, and you could do this 5 times, we call it the 5-finger breathing. Go up your finger, 3 seconds, breathe in, hold it, breathe out, down your finger, counting to 5 or 7. Breathe in, up, go down 5 to 7 with your out breath. if you even repeat this five times, you'll have cultivated a pause and reminded your body, we are not in an emergency right now. Put the brakes on a little bit, slow down. You'll have a higher chance of accessing that cortex. So much more I could say about the breath, Julie, but I wanted to start there.
Well, why don't you lead us in one long breath or something?
Yes, let me do
all
that.
Experiences. Do you want music or do you want, or just to do this? What
Let's
would you
do
like?
No music this okay. time. I tend okay. to be a person that becomes more, I work out to music because I get activated, and then let's just for other people not have music. Okay.
Okay.
So an invitation to shut your cameras off. If you want, close your eyes or cast your gaze on something that's gentle or safe or calm to yourself. Take your first deep breath in through your nose for a count of three. Hold it at the top. And exhale for a count of 5 to 7. Your next deep breath in, count to three. 1, 2, 3. Hold it at the top and then exhale. Counting 5 to 7 in your exhale. Now I'm going to invite you to do one more thing. Just focus on your eyeballs, just the eyeballs. And while you're focusing on the eyeballs, notice how they feel. Even notice all the way to the back of your eyeballs. Are you noticing tension? Are you noticing calm? And is there a way for you to intentionally try to relax your eyeballs and your eyes and around your eyes? Take one more deep breath in 3 seconds. Hold it at the top and release, exhaling for a count of 5. Let's invite ourselves to come back, open our eyes. If you want, turn your camera on. And one last thing, just rolling your shoulders up and down 3 times. By doing all of this, we've just sent messages to our body to ground ourselves, to find calm by using the out breath, noticing our eyeballs, moving our shoulders. Those were 3 things we used to calm our body.
Thank you, Julie.
Can I jump in and ask a quick question here?
Yeah.
We're talking about breathing. I've heard 2 separate ways over my lifetime about breathing. So I'm just trying to get some clarification for my own self.
Yep.
But I've heard, of course, breathing in is breathing in. But then when people say to breathe out, are you supposed to do that through your nasal passage or through your mouth?
There are many, many biomechanics and different techniques and strategies, nasal breathing and different breathing techniques. The way that you can start that's simple and not complex is just breathe in through your nostrils 3 seconds and then breathe out through your mouth 5 seconds. And the longer out breath will then mean that you're putting the brakes on a little bit. And if you repeat that a few times, it can even be several reminders to your body. And then Dina, there are so many other different techniques that I'm sure you've heard of and learned, like the nasal breathing, holding one nostril, and several other strategies that I know we can cover forever if we wanted to. Maybe in the future, Dina, we've talked about that.
Okay. Whoops. Okay. So this won't come as any surprise to all of you, and especially I'm imagining, I've not been to your state, but from everything I see, it just looks stunning. And like this slide was made for all of you. There is a lot of research that shows that being in nature or having access to seeing images of nature or greenery, it absolutely reduces stress and can support healing. I mean, it's amazing what some of the research shows. Not only can it reduce the, for some people, being in nature and having that full sensory experience, they've seen that it can reduce high blood pressure. It can increase the generation of natural killer cells, right, which sort of attack cancers and other things in the body. But it, for today's purposes, we're going to talk about how important it is to rejuvenate, to refresh, and to regulate and reduce your stress. For all of you, it seems to me that you have access to the outdoors, and even it doesn't even have to be a long time. Like Bruce Perry will say, even giving yourself a 5-minute break to go outside, it's the wash of all of that sensory information, especially if you're walking or running, or I know a lot of you ride horses and things like that. There's the somatosensory, but it will regulate and calm you. But if you find yourself, you're inside with children, the weather's inclement, something like this, just having images of nature available or bringing in pieces of nature, flowers, greenery, things, this can absolutely regulate and support health and healing and stress reduction. So I wanted to just say, like, I bet you all do that. And here's why it makes you feel so good. And keep doing it and bring it in as much as you can into your, you know, your daily self-care routine. So for a lot of us, too, exercise is just, you know, amazing and helpful and part of a self-care routine. And I know that there's different levels of accessibility around that. But if you can combine relational regulation, so you do it with somebody you care for, this sense of being in the outside and having some kind of exercise that's increasing your heart rate activity, I mean, you can see all of these ways that you are not only building buffers that will support you and buffer you like those bumper cars from having any negative impacts of stress, but you're also keeping yourself calm, rejuvenating your spirit. Sometimes having the hardest workout, bike ride, horseback ride, canoeing, you're tired, you're exhausted, but it sends you into a deep sleep and you wake up and you feel refreshed and rejuvenated. Okay. So we just wanted to say, are these, you know, again, mirrors, windows, sliding glass doors? Do you see things that work for you that you want to do more of, that you want to try? And I put this in here. These are, we often train with my dear colleague, Marianne Doan. Marianne identifies with two different tribal nations. She's a Native American woman, and she talks a lot about that and how, you know, her concepts of self and care and healing are so related to her Indigenous perspectives and routines. And for her, she's, you know, and her community and her context, having an animal spirit is a really, has always been a very important part of her self-care routine. Now, what she's careful to do is talk about, we never want to appropriate, you know, somebody else's spiritual, very serious spiritual or cultural routine. So she doesn't talk about her specific ways in which she thinks about the spirit animals, but in groups that are larger, she will share that she invites us to think about our connection to animals, our connection in relationship to animals in the land. And she'll say, you know, think about an animal, and I'm just going to show you some, here's some pictures, and I'll go to the next page. I want you, and she will give this invitation, I'm extending it to you today. I want you to think about an animal and a characteristic of that animal. It might be something you live with in Wyoming in your community or not, but think about a characteristic of that animal. So if you think about a lion, you might think about courage. If you think about, oftentimes people will think about spiders as having that sort of, you know, weaving of a web of interdependence and connection between things. You know, think of some characteristic of an animal and how it might relate to you and your spirit and who you are. And so there's this connection that you have to that animal. That's kind of the essence for her of this, you know, this deep connection. And she'll often think about that relational connection, but it will also be a grounder and kind of help her think about who she is and how to claim her full identities, but also be thinking about stress reduction and care and community for herself and the earth. So we're going to give it just a minute. I'm going to put on some background music. I want you to just think about what might be, whoops, let me go back the other way. What might be an animal for you that you relate to and why? What's one characteristics that you associate with that animal and that speaks to you? And let's just listen and learn from each other what those are. So we have a dog and loyalty for Dina.
Give it time and we wonder why. Do what we can. Laugh and we cry and we sleep.
Oh, nice. A dog is honest to his or her owner. We learn about your strengths through this too. It's beautiful.
Tears and grace.
Oh, Aaron, thank you. Elephant is protective and loyal.
Seen it all before.
Julie, do you want to keep reading some of them out loud?
Yes, the buffalo is strong, the deer is peaceful and calm. The snow owl reminds me of my sweet grandson because of Harry Potter and the Hedgewitch. The sloth, not a care in the world, no pressures or hurry.
There's a few that we missed. You might go back up a little bit.
Dog, honest to their owner, elephant, protective and loyal. We got that. Oh, beautiful. Okay. Cat, spunky, lovable, unpredictable, and another cat. Love to be curious, fun, and play. Ah, true mama bear, protective, fierce, and nurturing. The curiousness of weasels and the strong sense of community. I'll add mine. Hummingbird, because I have so much energy.
I love it.
Owl, very alert.
We'll give it just a few more seconds. But we hope you see this is inspired by my colleague and her indigenous cultural practices as forms of self-care and community care. She often talks about how they think about their spirit animals in many ways throughout life, to share story, to share connection, to share moments of strength and healing together.
We have another one, Julie, the wolf, strong, resourceful leader, but family oriented. Wow.
Beautiful. And such a great example of how relational connection doesn't have to be human. It can be the other than human here. Okay.
And on the backside of the zones of self-awareness, we have something that's called grounders. Things that ground us when we do have that stress that we can't predict or control. And we've already mentioned many of these: people, imaginary or animals or real people, objects. I'm Lebanese, and when I used to go visit my grandmother in Ohio, we call her Siti in Arabic. And she used to hold that rosary. I have it next to me here, her rosary. And she would say her prayers: Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, Hail Mary, full of grace, one bead after another. So it was the object that grounded her, but also the prayer that grounded her as well. And I think the relationship to God. So for she used three strategies in one sitting. And sometimes an image can ground us, like the animals that we looked at, or the pictures of nature or an activity. I indicated that I'm a hummingbird, right? I literally live in an anxious body that has a lot, enormous amounts of energy. And I need to do a lot of movement to ground this type of body that I live in. And so I need more movement than maybe other people do, but activities can be many things to you. So we're going to just invite you to think about that as you go along and take the zones of self-awareness handout and practice more as you wish on your own time as well.
Okay, so this one, this is a top-down strategy, you know, using a mantra or a saying to calm, connect, reduce your stress. And you'll see a lot of mantras here. There might be some that you use. There might be other ones that you don't see here that you find really valuable. We welcome you sharing them publicly or privately in the chat. But this is, you know, you're using a thought to calm you and regulate you. So that's a classic top down. But we wanted to bring in that continuum of the sort of self-care as a self, as an individual, and the self-care as community care, self-connected to the community. Do you see this picture here in the top left? This is an actual bridge here in Northern California. And they were, and it's a very steep bridge that goes down into a giant valley. And this community was experiencing a lot of suicide, people going to the bridge. And it was like a cluster set of suicides, you know, where there were so many right in a row. And the community was experiencing trauma over this because it just felt, they didn't feel like they had a sense of control and agency. More and more people just kept jumping from the bridge. And it was so awful for them. One person stopped by this bridge and left a little note. And it said, "You matter." And another person stopped by the bridge and added their own little note. "I care about you, even if I don't know you." And people started adding notes to the bridge here with mantras or sayings or aspects of a prayer that was a community-held way of creating a sense of support, relational support, but ended up buffering the stress enough that what happened was when this, you can, and this is an actual picture of what it looked like. These collective notes, we don't know why. I mean, we can have a sense of why, but it stopped the suicide clusters from happening. And some people left notes with phone numbers or resources that people could call and to get help. But I just felt like this was a beautiful example of how self-care doesn't have to be an individual self. It can be self in relationship to community.
Which sort of reminds us that when we, Linda Jones, one of the administrators in an early childhood program we interviewed for our book, you know, we, in our books, we have a philosophy to access collective wisdom across the country and even the world, and that we all hold wisdom within us. And so she says, "I attend weekly services and feel like being a part of my church community is helpful to me because I'm around like-minded people that I have a relationship with." I could just add so much more, Julie, the music, the community, the relational regulation, higher power. I mean, there's the mantras, the prayer, the movement you do when you sing. Oh, so much.
And this is what a lot has been lost during the pandemic, or a lot of people have felt like this has been lost. And so I think we put this here not to make you feel guilty if it has been harder for you to have this, because we want to acknowledge the stressors and the lived realities and the truths. And also to say, when you lost that, or when you had less access to it, it increased your stress. So if there's any way, even if you can't get to your faith-based service every week, or you know, your quilting club or your choir or what have you, if you can't do it in the same way, if it doesn't meet weekly, now it meets on Zoom once a month and it just doesn't feel the same, know that even a little bit of a dose of that relational connection will help. And that we have to give ourselves and others grace. We can't be in the world of perfection right now. It's just, there's just constant things that are just happening, and we have to be constantly saying, "This is what I can do right now." And part of actually recognizing state-dependent functioning is knowing that when we're up on the arousal continuum, not just as individuals, but groups, schools, programs, we're going to be capable of doing less. we don't have as much access to our cortex. So we have to give ourselves grace and just say, we're going to have to be flexible. This is what I'm capable of. This is what I can do right now. And attuning to that, hearing that and being responsive to that is really important. And I just want to take a minute to say thank you to Ashley. Being able to name that I'm having a hard time, it's hard. It takes courage to be vulnerable, but by you doing that, name it to tame it. You're allowing other people to maybe name what they're going through and remember that one of the stressors that leads to more toxic stress and trauma is feeling a sense of isolation. So by that act of courage and naming this, you help others feel less alone. And when we can bear witness to things together, we are in a better, because of relational regulation, a better opportunity to heal together. Okay. This came, you know, we're pulling all these quotes from our book, but these are all interviews we did with folks across the country. So Monique Lee said, one of the things I do is she has a daily gratitude practice. She says, I try to find gratitude in my day because there's always something that's happened good, even just a little thing. She said, I'm looking outside my window and I see the leaves blowing and I'm thinking, you know, it's just nice that there's a breeze out today. I'm grateful for that. I'm grateful that I can go out and see that. And she says, I've learned that I have to stop and just take a break and just ask myself a question. Where is there joy? What's giving me joy in today? What can I be grateful for? And I want to just ask you to do that at this moment. Just think about what is one thing today that's given you joy or one thing you can be grateful for. And share those in the chat box. It, you know, everything from I saw a butterfly's wing that really just brought a smile to my face. to, you know, I'm thankful to be here with my colleagues. We saw a lot of people thankful to be with their team, or maybe you got to see, you're looking at a picture on your phone of a grandchild or something, but, you know, finding those gratitude moments is so beautiful. And I want to bring this back to, remember I said a resilience narrative is along with relational connection, these are the two most powerful things to help people protect themselves from short and long-term harm from stress and trauma. And so having a daily gratitude like this allows you to create those resilience narratives. So we'll share a few. I'm close to my family and I hug them. Seeing the picture of that bridge a few slides ago. Thank you, Rachel. Simply life, my family, my job, my puppies, my memories, being able to have Zoom for real. Oh, that's great. Well, keep those coming. We're aware. I'm just noticing the time and we want to make sure we have time for Q&A, video chats with my family and kids. So keep those coming. Cindy. Blessed to have the love of my family. The beauty of the winter makes me, oh, I love that, heart happy. I love that language. That's lovely. Grateful for a warm home. Happy birthday, Kim. Today's your birthday and being around family is great. Caring neighbors, learning new things. Beautiful. We'll just keep those coming. And I'm going to share this strategy with you because it's, again, all of our wisdom comes from all of you in the field. This comes from a group in on the East Coast who said, this was a director of an early childhood program. And she said, you know, self-care has focused too much on what we can do for ourselves. She said, I really want to think about organizational care and how I can bring that into my program and our system here. And so what they did is they took that body scan, that idea that Julie walked you through. They thought about what are the physiological, the body reminders that I'm getting stressed? What do I look like when I'm feeling stressed? I'm going into the orange zone or maybe in the red zone. And they shared with each other, you know, so it'd be Julie sharing with Dina. Well, when I get stressed, I clench my teeth or I avert my gaze. And then Ruby or Ashley says, when I get stressed, they just took time in a staff meeting to share those stressors. And then they said, what we'll do is we'll have a code word. If I notice that my colleague is showing those signs of stress that they had told me were those activated stress, you know, signals, we're going to have a code word. And I'm going to walk up to my colleague and say, hey, there's a call for you. Do you, you know, there's a call for you. And then that colleague would, this is code for you look a little stressed and I'm checking in on you. The colleague could say, thanks so much, I'll take that call. And she gets 2 minutes to go get, you know, to do a deep breath, say a mantra, get a glass of water, whatever it was. Or she can say, thank you, can you take a message? And that meant, you know, thank you for checking in on me. I care. I'm so thankful that you cared about me. I'm good. And that way they were able to have this sort of language without saying in front of the children, I'm really feeling activated and stressed out, maybe by that child, you know, so that they prevented the child from feeling shame or self-critique and those cycles of self-doubt. Some other people have said that they, you know, get on the speaker and say, I need a little sunshine and down in room two. And other groups have text chats, group chats, and they'll say, you know, I need a break or what have you. But just normalizing that we all have those activated times and that we can create cultures of self-care and regulation together is a really, really beautiful approach. Julie, did you want to add anything?
No.
Okay. And we're going to wrap up now so we have time for your Q&A. Do you want to just talk them through this real quick?
Yeah. So this comes from our book. It's actually a handout that you've been provided. We actually have it in three different languages, but it is called the Health and Wellness Toolkit. And the best way that I can describe it is in our country, we have something called My Healthy Plate, right? That tells people eat these foods to stay optimally healthy. We're recommending a whole toolkit, a whole health and wellness toolkit that has 10 categories. When you look at the handout on your own later, if you wish, or do with your teams if you want, it'll have definitions for each category. So if you don't remember what I say today, there's definitions and places to journal of your strengths and your learning edges. But I will briefly just mention each one. Play and fun. You know, that thing we do when we don't think, we just lose ourselves in something that brings us joy. Self-reflection, you get hours and hours of credit for tuning inward today, but there are many ways to do that. Prayer, meditation, quiet walks, mindful walks, daydreaming and mind wandering. We talked about that also today. Sleep time and sleep hygiene does not just involve how much sleep you uniquely need. Some people need 4, some 6, some 10, but it's also the hygiene that's surrounding your sleep. I'm somebody that can't watch scary things before bed because it sticks to me like Velcro and then comes into my dreams at night. Dina's raising her hand. But also, can you drink caffeine at all? Can you drink it before bed? What do you eat before bed? And the last thing is just your devices mimic and disrupt your melatonin cycles. So if you're actually doing a lot of screen time before bed, your body's not naturally releasing melatonin that tells you to sleep. Relationships and community, right? We talked about that today, the number one strategy. Environments that we put ourselves in, right? That ground us and protect us, that make us feel comfortable. I had one teacher tell me it's the broom closet at work, right? So sometimes it's not what you expect. Another teacher, the car, yelling and screaming in the car while I'm driving. Intellectual time is where you learn and stimulate your neurosynaptic connectors when you gain new information from something new you learn. Work time does not just include working. It also includes the ability to say, I need time off and away. Physical, or even saying no sometimes and not taking too much on your plate, or balancing and prioritizing your time. Physical activity, for all of us, it's different. Some people like Tai Chi, Qigong, yoga. Others need intense physical activity. Each of us has a different pathway where movement can regulate us. And finally, spiritual and religious time. And for all of us, that's different. There's thousands of religions around the world and pathways to find spirituality. And I hope you'll use this tool that we provided you to work on as you continue on this journey.
Yeah, we'd love to hear. It doesn't even have to be a question. It could just be something that you're thinking about or something that is a takeaway for you.
And if there are no questions, I think, you know, we can move right on and continue. I'm not sure if I do have a few things that I hope that you guys will stick around. I have a few things to post in the chat in just a moment at the end. So we will. Yeah, there's so many. You have given us such a wealth of information today. I think for me, just trying to process all this. And Julie, it's funny that you say that your body, like you're so energetic, and I see that about you, but I also like you are so calming. And so like your voice is just is very calming. And so it's interesting that you've learned to balance those things.
Thanks for having us. It's an honor and a privilege to be with you.
Thank you so much. And Dina, I know you might want to make some more announcements, but I love this one comment saying, I love the refresher of all these things we know and have heard, but forget. Like it's so easy to fall asleep to ourselves, right? And then to just be in that zombie mode, reacting left and right, and how we can pause and wake up to these things that we already know. So thank you.